Dear children, let us start with a new chapter, the Delhi Sultanate, Chapter 3. Dear children, we have studied in the previous chapter that the defeat of Prithviraj Chauhan by Muhammad Ghori in 1192 CE laid the foundation of Turkish rule in India. Muhammad Ghori was killed in 1206 CE. He had no heir. So, his generals declared themselves independent in different parts of his empire. One of his generals, Qutbuddin Aibak, assumed control of Muhammad Ghori's Indian possessions and laid the foundation of the Delhi Sultanate. The period between 1206 CE to 1526 CE is known as the period of Delhi Sultanate. This is because the rulers of this period were known as sultans and they ruled from their capital city, Delhi. Delhi first became the capital of a kingdom under the Tomaras, a Rajput dynasty of early 12th century. It became an important commercial center also. Coins minted here were called Deliwal, which had a wide circulation. Delhi became the capital of the vast areas of the subcontinent only under the Delhi Sultanate. During this period, rulers belonging to five different dynasties ruled in Delhi. These were the Slave Dynasty from 1206 to 1290 CE, the Khalji Dynasty from 1290 to 1320 CE, the Tughlaq Dynasty 1320 to 1414 CE, the Sayyid Dynasty from 1414 to 1451 CE, the Lodi Dynasty from 1451 to 1526 CE. Let us first discuss about the sources of the Delhi Sultanate. The inscriptions, coins, and monuments like forts, mosques, tombs, and temples provide ample information about the history of this period. In addition to these, there are travelers' accounts and court chronicles that provide information about events and lives of kings and ordinary people. The authors held an official position and spent a lot of time at the court of a king. Ziauddin Barani wrote Tarikh-e-Firoz-Shahi. It starts with the accession of Balban and comes down to the early years of Firoz Tughlaq. Minaz-e-Siraj wrote the early history of Sultanate of Delhi. Indo-Islamic, Indo-Arabic, Persian, Urdu, Arabic and bilingual inscriptions are also found on various archaeological sources like Qutub Minar, Atala Masjid, Jama Masjid and Adina Masjid, etc. The rulers of this dynasty were called slaves or mamluk. In Arabian language, mamluk means owned. Iltutmish and Balban were slaves of Qutbuddin Aibak, who himself was a slave of Muhammad Ghori. The first ruler of the slave dynasty was Qutbuddin Aibak, who was in charge of the territories conquered by Muhammad Ghori in India. He was the founder of the slave dynasty. He ruled only for 4 years. During his reign, he devoted his entire attention in strengthening his position and kingdom. He was a kind-hearted, just, and generous ruler. Due to his generosity, he was called Lakh Baksh or Giver of Lakhs. He gave large sums of money in charity. He also started the construction of the Qutub Minar, but due to his sudden death at Lahore, his successor Iltutmish completed it. Later, Firoz Shah Tughlaq added fifth and the last story to it. Qutub Minar was used as a minar by Muslims for prayers. Qutbuddin was succeeded by his son, but soon he was replaced by Iltutmish, the son-in-law of Qutbuddin Aibak. He is considered to be the real founder of Islamic Empire in India. He ruled from 1210 to 1236 CE. Actually, he was the first Sultan of Delhi in the strict sense of the term. Under his rule, the slave dynasty was able to find a strong footing. He not only suppressed the rebellious chiefs and nobles, but his powerful rivals and the Khaljis of Bengal to protect the Muslim Empire in India. He destroyed the power of Rajput princes and brought the whole of North India under his control. Instead of Lahore, he made Delhi the capital and center of the Muslim Empire. He also received the title of Sovereign Sultan of Delhi from the Caliph of Baghdad. Iltutmish introduced the silver taka and the copper jital, the two basic coins of the Sultanate period. He completed the construction of the Qutub Minar in Delhi, started by Qutubuddin Aibak. He introduced the Iqtadari system, division of the empire into Iqtas, which were assigned to the nobles and officers in lieu of salary. Iltutmish had many sons, but none of them was capable of being his successor. So he appointed Razia as his successor. But the nobles of the court refused to welcome a woman as the ruler. They offered the throne to her brother Firuz Shah. Razia Sultan was unique in the history of the Delhi Sultanate. She was the first and the last woman Muslim ruler of the medieval period. Razia established complete law and order in her reign. She used to dress up like a man while appearing in court or in the battlefield. The Turkish nobles resented having a woman as their ruler. They began to conspire against her. Turkish officers deposed her from the throne of Delhi and made her brother Bahram the Sultan. Razia died in 1240 CE. After the death of Razia and till the accession of Balban, many kings came to the throne. Of them, Nasiruddin Mahmud, another son of Iltutmish, ruled from 1246 to 1266 CE. He was a puppet in the hands of powerful nobles. Balban was the most powerful ruler of the slave dynasty. He had been an important noble since the reign of Iltutmish and was the real power behind Nasiruddin Mahmud. Balban reorganized and strengthened the army. He fought against the local rulers and defeated many of them. He also guarded the northwestern borders against Mongol invasions. Balban wanted the people to look up to the Sultan. He introduced the Persian customs of sajda and paibos or zamindos. People were against this, as they felt such customs were reserved for God alone. Balban's successors were weak. In 1290 CE, the Khalji nobles captured the throne of Delhi. A grandson of Balban was killed and the Sultanate passed into the hands of the Khaljis. That's all for now. Thank you.